Good evening. It is always a daunting one to stand in front of this collective body of wisdom, of learning, of cultivation. I was very, very moved by what Leslie said a few minutes ago, because in fact, it's that brief which more than anything else persuaded me to give up the vineyards of Freiburg in Breisgau, where I was teaching piano, and come to Harvard, not to give fingerings to people, but because I thought that if somebody didn't train the future audiences, then the social contract with the future artists might not hold. It was Christoph Wolff who was instrumental in persuading me to consider the post at Harvard, and I owe Christoph so many things that when I introduce him in a future meeting, I shall go into the details. But my devotion to being here in Cambridge has a great deal to do with understanding the gravity of the situation that Leslie outlined. And I have given in high schools in this country, at universities, at Harvard clubs, at music festivals, a talk called Who Cares If Classical Music Dies? Maybe someday I'll give it here. But today, my brief is a different one. And it takes its point of departure from the very first presentation I made before this gathering, in which the subject was improvising Mozart. And to not be composing Mozart, and you might think, well, that must be a good deal easier, because at least you have an eraser on your pencil and you can continue to rethink things. And that, of course, is true. Improvising in a style means that the vernacular of that particular style has been learned enough and has become second nature enough that you can afford to take large risks. Nonetheless, improvisation is something of the moment. Yes, if it's recorded, it can be played back, but it is not the same thing and never will represent the same thing as a polished piece of work. Now, completing Mozart is a cottage industry which began when Mozart was barely cold in his grave. This is something I think that needs to be said. At the funeral of Mozart, just a couple of days after Mozart passed away in the St. Michael's Church in Vienna, the first two movements of his Requiem were performed, but the second of those, the Kyrie Fugue, was not filled out in its instrumental doublings by Mozart before he died. And so assistants had to come in to make that portion of the piece playable at his funeral. And of course, as we all know, the work was then subsequently finished by Mozart's assistant Franz Xaver Süssmayr, who also finished the D major horn concerto, and the industry was in full swing. It was, in fact, abetted by a man named Maximilian Stadler, about whom I'll have quite a bit to say this evening, a court counselor who aided Mozart's widow Constanze in the ordering of Mozart's musical estate, and in an effort to give her more marketable pieces, took a number of unfinished Mozart pieces and completed them. Now, of course, to speak of completing Mozart could give us the impression that Mozart has a vernacular, a lingo, and as sophisticated as, and I think all of you know, that it is a very sophisticated language which is masked by an appearance of simplicity. Hence Arthur Schnabel's remark that the problem with Mozart was that it was too easy for children and too difficult for grown-ups. The fact that once one gets a little bit older, one begins to realize that as easy as it is to whistle a tune from a Mozart opera, trying to figure out how he makes it so uncannily simple and yet so deep in terms of our emotions is really quite an extraordinary feat. Anyhow, if you think about Mozart, you will soon realize that he does not have a single vernacular, but a whole plethora of vernaculars. That is, how his style develops from the time he's five and first starts to compose over this 30-year creative lifespan until he dies at the age of 35. And it is not merely a question of the progress of his language, because like most artists, Mozart develops in a certain trajectory until, like rotating the barrel of the lens of a single lens reflex camera, Everything reaches what you could call an optimum state in which what you wish to say and how you say it could not be more ideal in terms of their potency, in terms of their lyricism, in terms of their genius. But the thing about it is that composers and painters and writers and sculptors and so on don't stop rotating the barrel of the lens when they get to that point, because they continue to develop, and at that point their music starts to become peculiar, idiosyncratic. Beethoven, of course, is the ideal example in which the middle period represents that high focus, the period of the Eroica Symphony and the Fourth Symphony, the Violin Concerto, the Fourth Piano Concerto, the Razumovsky Quartets, some of our favorite pieces, lasting up to the Archduke Trio, up into the Opus 90s. Ah, but then come the late piano sonatas and the late string quartets, the Ninth Symphony, the Missa Solemnis, the pieces which still remain intellectually as a testament to one of the most intense and most profound chroniclers of the human condition that civilization has produced. But Mozart also had that kind of a trajectory, and in about 1784 he reaches the apogee. And that apogee lasts for about 2 years and something, and then in 1787 he too continues to rotate the barrel and his music starts to get a little strange. And then, of course, it matters whether he's writing a piece to entertain that's played in the background while the champagne is being poured and the people are eating the canapés, or whether he happens to be writing a piano sonata, which is going to be a piece of consumer material played by the daughters of the bourgeoisie and the daughters of counts and countesses and so on and so forth, or whether it's going to be a string quartet, or whether it's going to be an opera, or for that matter, it's going to be a piece of church music with a distinctly archaic flavor. So there are languages of Mozart, and there is no one way to compose him. The way one can possibly evoke what he had in mind is dependent upon being able to read all of these sub-languages and master them one way or another. Now, I'm going to evoke this challenge by playing certain pieces for you, some of which I know you will know, hence I'm playing them for you, and others which I'm fairly sure you do not know, which gives a certain advantage, because a lack of familiarity will breed a lack of expectation. You don't really know how it goes, so you'll just follow it wherever it happens to lead you. Now, Mozart is unique in the arts, in the Western arts, in terms of the sheer number of substantial torsos that he left behind. There are always pieces that composers will give up, but most of the pieces abandoned by composers are abandoned because the composer grew dissatisfied with them, realized they weren't going anywhere. Now, Mozart has his fair share of those dry runs, and some of them last a matter of seconds, like this one. Well, I think we know the next note is. But maybe the problem was getting beyond that note. We actually know what piece that was designed for, and what he replaced it with, and I think we all agree he was right, was. The second movement of the C minor piano concerto. And we know that because it's on the same kind of paper. Forensic studies have added a great deal to our understanding of Mozart. Wolfgang Plott, the great Mozart scholar, could look at a natural or a sharp in a manuscript and say, 1772, and probably the first half. And Alan Tyson made an inventory of all of the paper that Mozart used, and comparing the dated pieces with the non-dated pieces, he changed the chronology of certain pieces by as much as 10 years, which in a 30-year lifespan is quite astonishing. So you look at this and realize that this person left 140 major musical works, not those dry runs, but pieces which were viable. Why? Because he was a short order cook. When someone knocked at the door and needed a wind serenade, it didn't matter that he was writing a string quartet. If he wanted to make money and feed his wife and his children, he had to do what was being asked for. So he put things aside. And the interesting thing is, from the paper types which Alan Tyson inventoried, we can see that many completed musical fragments of Mozart were ultimately finished by him when the time came and the money was there. So there are many more fragments than we actually see today. And so if you want to know what Mozart might have written if he had lived to 1792, 93, 94, and so on, the evidence is in those fragments. So, it's time to play some music, and I'm going to play a piece that I think some of you know. It's a piece that may or may not be for piano. It was published as Minuet by W.A. Mozart with Trio by Maximilian Stadler. Remember him? It's not going to be on the exam. And Mozart evidently had something to do with this piece. Tchaikovsky loved it, and he orchestrated it in his fourth orchestral suite, Mozartiana. And I therefore suspect that many of you will recognize it. I'm going to play it without comment, and then we're going to start to do some criminological investigation. Well, it's Mozart, all right, and it's obviously not early Mozart either. The twisted chromaticism and the serene ending make perhaps slightly disturbing bedfellows in this piece, but nonetheless, there's no mistaking the fingerprint. Now, when this piece was published in the complete works of Mozart, Wolfgang Plath, the editor of this volume, suggested that actually perhaps this piece might have been a fragment. The very fact that Stadler was involved in the trio already creates a by-authorship. But he was not, Plath, the first person to make this suggestion. The first person to make it was a distinguished theorist named Ernst Oster in the Yale Journal of Music Theory, which some 50 years ago got the idea that in each issue it would ask distinguished musicians to discuss a piece, and they'd hire three people, and each one of them would contemplate something. The very first piece under examination was this. One of the collaborators could not get the contribution in on time, and so there were only two to speak of this piece. And Oster suggested, in fact, that this piece might be a fragment. And what caught his eye, he's a very, very astute observer, is what happens once we get back to the beginning, where you'll notice Mozart starts. And you will notice that how much he dislikes the predictability of literal repetition. So when he comes back, he doesn't go. No, he goes. And only here does he reluctantly take us back to where we were before. Now, it's exactly what happens thereafter that catches the ear of a suspicious listener. The first time, and on we go. The second time, what we hear is this. Now, you might say, now what's wrong with that? I want you to listen for a minute. There's something wrong with that. It seems jerry-built in some way. And so one starts to ask, well, what happened? And I thought, Stadler wants to complete this piece. What's the simplest way to do it? To take the end of the first half and repeat it. Not in the key of A major in order to get to here, but in this key. So he will copy it literally, therefore. You see, that becomes very, very easy. Predictable, which of course Mozart doesn't like, but easy. In order to get there, he invents this, which, as I say, that's okay, but this doesn't work. Now you might think, well, wait a second. Mozart's writing this minuet and he's 30 seconds short of the ending it. Why did he stop writing it down? Oster suggested that he stopped writing it down because he couldn't figure out a satisfactory end to it. He wanted to trump himself and he couldn't do so, so he abandoned the piece. That, I think, misunderstands Mozart's working methods. The obvious answer to anyone who studied his music very well is this. He stopped writing it down because at that point everything was clear. It was so obvious how the ending needed to go that he did not need to write it down because 3 days, 3 months, 3 years, 30 years later, he would know what it was. And then I thought, well, Stadler didn't figure it out. Can I? Is it too complicated for mere mortals like us? Or might it be that it's so simple that no one would have thought of it? And I thought and thought and thought about this silly little bar. Then I went back to the beginning. Now, as you can all hear, it's symmetrical. It's what we call a sequence. So hearing that it's iterated three times might mask from you the fact that the symmetry changes. That is, this is now lower, and now it's higher. So I thought to myself, wait a minute. What happens if you don't change the symmetry? You end up where you need to be. Oh. There's only one problem with it. It doesn't jump. So you gotta jump. See, you have to try to figure out how this man is thinking and to understand when to be overambitious is dangerous or whether to be underambitious is dangerous. We're going to see both of these cases in the next couple of minutes. Now, at the end of this first half, Mozart writes, he comes right down and plays all the notes of the chord in which he's going to end. Now, you cannot do that the second time because you'll need this note. Or else, you're going to end too low. And it's not satisfying because it's a little bit too dark in color. What does Stadler do? He does this. Which is not bad at all. It's actually quite a good idea, but what it doesn't do is to give the sense of falling, which is very necessary to give the sense of finality. So the problem is that he runs out of room because this is the top note on his piano, and you want to do something that will nonetheless descend. This is a case where I think you need to be more ambitious rather than less ambitious. So here's the second half in an attempted reconstruction. I won't say the problem is solved, But, you know, there it is on the table, and you can decide whether you'll taste it. For our next example, we're going to go to something quite a bit more intriguing, this painting. Now, this painting shows Mozart at the age of 14 in Verona. Fine. It shows him at a harpsichord in a higher resolution rendering of this, which I was unable to obtain. You can actually read the year in which the harpsichord was made, and quite a bit else. Notice the rather strange hand position of his right hand. I think it would appall almost any conservatoire teacher today. But what is more interesting is the question of this piece, which is on the music rack. Now, as I think most of you will know, when painters depict musicians, they very often depict the music that they're playing. But they almost inevitably show no interest whatsoever in an accurate depiction of those notes, A, because most of them can't read music, and B, because they know that 99.9% of the people contemplating the picture also can't read it, and therefore there is no incentive whatsoever to render the music exactly as it is. Except in this painting, when you look at it from close up, you can read every single note. And from its layout, it is almost certain that it is a copy of a piece by Mozart. Not surprising. Would he, in fact, have consented to be portraited by, you know, somebody there playing the piece of somebody else? Scarcely. So the interesting thing is that at the age of 14, Mozart was not composing keyboard music, and so this is the only evidence of any piece for keyboard that Mozart might have written at the time. And this is the only evidence for this piece that we have. It exists only in this painting. Now, if that intrigues you, what I'm about to say may intrigue you even a little bit more. In making this painting, the painter had to deal with an interesting problem of perspective. Because as you notice, the music rack, like most music racks, is tilted backwards. In tilting backwards, you can see that the line of the music runs not perpendicular to the painting, but is tilted slightly to the right. This means that from here up to there, that this portion of the page is cut off by the frame. This means, therefore, that a painter depicting how that music looks on the page in the context of that frame would cut off at least a bar from the top line and fractions of bars in the ones below until reaching the place in which you could view all of the music. Not the case. The music has been rearranged on the page so that it runs continuous. Now, I challenge you to think of another painting in which this is the case. It's really quite extraordinary. Clearly, Leopold or Wolfgang must have insisted that as this would be a calling card, that as much of the piece as could be made visible had to be there, its integrity not spoiled by mere matters of perspective. Another intriguing thing is if you look rather carefully, you'll see that it looks like the bottom line is blank. This could suggest that at the time he was portraited, he had begun the piece, but he hadn't finished it. So perhaps the fact that the only way this piece survives is in this painting, and therefore necessarily incomplete, actually represents how the piece was on that day. And as to whether Mozart ever finished it or not, there's no way to know, unless the manuscript shows up. Would you like to hear it? This is not the kind of style of Mozart to which you were accustomed. Shall we extrapolate? It is, to be sure, a crapshoot, you know, maybe and maybe not. But you have to immerse yourself in the world of this dialect and start to make geometrical, geographical sorts of strategic decisions. It's like reconstructing a chess game, you know, where maybe the middle 15 moves are gone and you have to try to figure out how the board could have gotten to that particular point. Now, in a case like that, you have architecture to deal with. The first thing you have to decide is where you are in the piece when it breaks off, so you know how much you still have to do. I'm going to give you another example now from a form which is the standard instrumental form, the sonata form, first movement form, and this is a piece which has an autobiographical significance because at a sighing figure in the middle, Mozart writes Sophie and Costanza, which were his future sister-in-law and his future wife. Sophie Weber and Constanze Weber. And I'm going to play you the fragment of this piece as it has come to us. Thank you. answer. Now that's a real loss. Very often, one of the most frustrating things about these Mozart fragments is how good they are. That is, they are not throwaways, they're not second or third rate Mozart, they're absolutely of the highest order, and in some cases they feel more original, more risky, more engaging than some of the finished pieces. Certainly more experimental. So Maximilian Stadler had this autograph and he continued and he wrote his completion into the piece, which I'm now going to play for you. Maximilian Stadler played it safe. All of us who've studied music appreciation know that sonatas have expositions, developments, and recapitulations. That is, they go from point A to point B, stuff happens, they come home, chastened, and then instead of going from point A to point B, they repeat all of the material you've had before, but they are absolutely, well-behaved, and they stay at home. Therefore, apart from the adjustment made to keep the picket fence locked and staying at home instead of going somewhere else, there are no adventures. And so it's possible to be quite literal in writing recapitulations. This, in fact, is what Maximilian Stadler does. But in order to prevent the piece from going from here to here, instead of trying to recompose something that will keep him from going home, he decides he will jump to here so that this becomes that, as you will hear. I'm just going to start from the recapitulation, assuming that you heard some of what you heard before. Now listen carefully. Different key. But now, everything before is here happening here too. With it. But nothing at all happens that you haven't heard. You know, everything is right with the world, but maybe it's just a little bit ordinary. Let's try to take a few risks. We first of all, this idea is the end of something, and it shouldn't start to wander somewhere else. I mean, that's a structural mistake, even if it sounds perfectly all right. So that's the first thing we're going to get rid of. You'll see about the rest. Thank you. So a few surprises along the way, along with the predictable. Too many surprises, and after a while, you stop playing at the table. You've got to win sometimes. But this constant feeling of volatility, I think, is very important. Leslie, how much time do I have? I don't know. A little bit more. Okay. A little bit more. You see, these contain beginnings. And from the beginnings, one divines the ends. The more of the piece that you have, the more it tends to define its own proportions and its own scale of predictability or unpredictability. The rhetoric itself will help you too. The less material you have, the more speculative you're going to be. Now, suppose you're actually writing a piece which is not even in your own style, but in the style of somebody else. For instance, a piece that begins like this. Overture. Doesn't sound like Mozart at all, does it? And after that, there's an allemande. And after that, there's a courant. The finger of Mozart seems to become a little bit more emergent, but still, he's writing with a crooked sort of message. I'm now going to play for you, from this suite, the Sarabande and the Gigue, and then I'll have something to say about both of them. I'm going to play for you the Mozartian material that was the instruction of those two pieces. First, the sarabande. And now the gigue. Not a lot to go on, is it? So the element of speculation there reaches and perhaps surpasses the untenable. But it's a way of trying to imagine a missing statue in a niche. Without a sarabande and a gigue, you don't have a suite. You can stop with the courant, as many people do, but it's not a very satisfactory feeling. If you have to construct something that allows you to get from the last arch of the Pont d'Avignon across the Rhone, and it's made out of plywood, it may not be an aesthetic pleasure, but it will get you across the river. And certainly the rewards of facing challenges like this as a creative musician are so intrinsically useful that regardless of how well the product comes out, still there's something to be said for it. I'm going to conclude tonight by showing you a final kind of conundrum, which emerged when I was working on my completion of the C minor Mass. This piece, as some of you may know, was one of many written for his wife, and like all of the others, was never finished. Certainly a case for Freud. And Mozart composed the entirety of the Kyrie and the Gloria. He drafted the first two movements of the Credo, but did not fully score them. And he then skipped the rest of the Credo and wrote the Sanctus and Benedictus, which unfortunately have not come down to us complete, because we have only the extra score of the instruments that didn't fit on the main score because there wasn't enough room for all of them. And that's been missing for 200 years. So most of the Credo is not there at all. The Agnus Dei and Dona Nobis Pacem are not there at all. And orchestration is missing for the two movements of the Credo that we have and for the Sanctus. And so all of this is a kind of vexing thing. Some of it you have to complete, some of it you have to reconstruct. The difference being you can reconstruct what once was and is gone, but you can't compose it in the same sense, because it's a different sort of choice. In order to do this, of course, the first thing you have to figure out is how Mozart would have done the Credo. How many movements would there have been in the Credo? Can we know? And the strange thing about Mozart is his architectural sense emerged when he was a tot. Basic decisions about proportions and order and hierarchy were made from the very outset, and his style evolved, but his sense of architecture remained the same. When he was 13, he wrote a Mass in C minor for an orphanage. And the exact apportionment of the Latin text to the individual movements is exactly the same as the C minor Mass, showing us exactly how many movements were missing. So there's that. So I then decided I would go through all of Mozart's sketches for 5 years, 2 years before he started and 2 years after he stopped it, to find anything that looked churchy, fugues, things like that, which could possibly have been intended for the Mass. In one case, I found a double fugue, which was surely supposed to be the next movement, the Crucifixus, because it's written on the same paper and with the same color ink. So those are smoking guns. Now, in one particular case, I came upon the following short little snippet, which I'd like to play for you. And it is the following. It's a very riveting passage. For all we know, it could have been copied from a church piece by somebody else. But it's his handwriting. So I'm not going to give up something like that. which is that good if I might be able to use it. But I can only use it if it fits a portion of the Latin Mass which is missing in Mozart's setting. It turns out that it fits very well, et expecto resurrectionem mortuorum. Very, very well. But that comes at the end of the movement in which you believe in the Holy and Apostolic Catholic Church. So in this case, what Mozart is writing is the culmination of the movement and not the beginning. So you have to start lower on the staircase and build something which will come up and culminate in this passage. Now, how will you do that? Well, you start by thinking, quite apart from anything else, the tortured chromaticism certainly has something that could connect to the dead and their resurrection, but not to the sunny glory of your belief in the church. What you might do in that case is then subtract the chromaticism, you see, and make it more normal. And then perhaps, instead of starting with imitation, start with chords. Now there's an idea. Shall we listen to how it sounds? So this is what these days is called reverse engineering. You see, you turn and look at the telescope in the wrong way and try to imagine a place that it came from. Well, you know, all of this, of course, is compared with anything he would have done, the work of a rank amateur. But, you know, it's a way, I think, of opening a window to all of us when we try to imagine what Schubert might have created, what Mozart might have created. These things, as speculative, as necessarily imperfect as they are, allow even musical lay persons to begin to get a sense of how the creative process works, what guesses are, and even your own individual intuition and imagination flowing. Thank you so much.